Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Professor Gad Barzilai. I am the Lucy and Herr Puzan Chair of the Stroum Jewish Studies Program at University of Washington. And this is a pleasure, a delight, and a great honor to open the 36th lecture in the series of the Stroum Lectures. As you know, the Stroum Lectures is in many ways our cutting edge leading front that allow us to bring on campus the best scholars in Jewish studies, which are publishing the best scholarship on relevant issues on Judaism and Jewish studies. And this is a great honor today to have with us one of the most important scholars of Jewish history and Judaism, who is prominent in different aspects of Judaism and Jewish studies, primarily American Jewish history. And Professor Jonathan Sarna, whom I will introduce later on today in a few moments, would give a series of two talks about revivals and awakening in American Judaism. His lecture today would be about the shaping of American Judaism, and obviously after his lecture, we are inviting you, first of all, to have QAs, questions, and later on, a reception in the Walker Ames Room in honor of our guest, Professor Jonathan Sarna. On Wednesday, May 11, Professor Sarna will talk about the reshaping of American Judaism. And momentarily, we will invite Professor Ashat Kasaba, the director of the Jackson School of International Studies, to make some opening remarks. As you know, we are very fortunate. The Jewish Studies program is embedded in the Jackson School of International Studies, which is a prominent, internationally renowned school, and we are obviously a proud unit within the Jackson School. But before we begin the formal facet of the evening, I would like, first of all, to thank all of you for coming. Students, board members, faculty members, the larger audience. I would like to thank four people who worked hard on organizing this event, in addition to our board members and the chair of the board, Mr. Bob Center. So I would like, first of all, to acknowledge Jennifer Cohen, the assistant director. If you look at Jen, she looks as a usual human being, but actually she's a superwoman. Well, with I mean with a much better dressing, but and I will also like to acknowledge Caroline Black, and Polly Hunter from Development, who are always very helpful, and Angelica Macklin, who has edited the tribute that you are going to see in a few moments. We are also very honored to have with us today Cynthia Stroum and their daughter Courtney, the daughter and granddaughter of late Althea Stroum. As you know, Althea Stroum passed away on March 14, and we shall miss her a lot. I want just to tell you two short anecdotes. One was we had a lecture given by Scott Nagel about the Song of Songs and the perception of love in Song of Songs. And Althea, it was about 2 years ago, Althea was so engaged in the lecture. She asked all the time questions, and Scott would give his own comments, and she would have her own comments on Scott's comments on the perception of love. It was very cute and funny, and she was really, really engaged. And the other, actually it was the last time that I saw her, it was an evening around the book by Noam Pianko. And she was, at this stage, she was quite fragile. It was clear that she doesn't feel so good. But it was very important for her to come to me immediately at the end of the event and tell me what she thinks about the event. And I knew her only in the last 3 years once I began my stint as chair of Jewish studies, but she always was very engaged in what we are doing. When I talked with her in the phone once I came into office, and I called her, she was very delighted to hear that I am native Israeli, and she asked me whether I know Moshe and Chaim from Hebrew University. It was really, really, she was such a lovely and interesting and a very engaging and engaged human being. So by your permission, a tribute for the memory of late Althea Stroum, a bless her memory.
Althea is now Stroum. I came to Seattle from New York when I was 14, and I thought the whole world was Jewish.
I will remember Althea forever, not only because of the role she played in the life of the school, but also because she was an utterly charming person.
I'll remember her as a presence, a person who made other people feel good.
She's down to earth. She was funny, very, very warm.
She had great jokes, none of which I can report in this public setting.
A great storyteller. You would never tire of hearing Althea's version of when she first met Scoop or when she first met her husband or stories about her children and family. It was always a delight to be around Althea.
And I would see her, you know, all over the place in civic roles and in university-related roles.
She had vision for what Jewish studies could be. She had vision for what the University of Washington could be. And she had vision for what she could contribute.
She had been with the Jackson School for a long time before I came along.
Very active in the Henry Art Gallery. And they were very prominent in the Jewish community.
My husband and I wanted to start something that would be a lifelong legacy.
The idea for a Jewish studies program started at the university in 1969, I think, when Eddie Alexander and several other people thought it would be a good idea to have something of a Jewish studies program. And at the time, this was a very new idea. There were very few Jewish studies programs anywhere in the country.
Murray Schiff was the one that was responsible for planting the seed.
Well, I think it's a perfect fit for the Jackson School. One, because the Jackson School is home of a comparative religion program. But it also fits in because the Jewish community is a worldwide community.
A critical event early in the history of the program was the creation of the Stroum Lectures. These were lectures for the local Seattle Jewish community, not just students, but people from outside the university as well.
We started the lecture series. It was something that was very important to the people, and we've been very pleased at the attendance. It has been unbelievable. And the speakers that we've had have been so outstanding.
These opportunities to hear these major scholars was just terrific and has been for 35 or 36 years now. But combined with that, right from the beginning, was the idea that these lectures would be published in the form of books put out by the University of Washington Press. And this means that you not only have the local audience that's appreciative, but you have other professors, and you have generation after generation of students all over the country benefiting from what is said at the Stroum Lectures.
She gave one of the largest gifts in the history of the university. That was after my time, but of course I knew about it.
One of the earliest endowments that the Stroums gave to the program was money for the Hazel D. Cole Fellowship. Now, it helps individual scholars who are just getting started on their career, but at the same time, it's done something wonderful for many universities around the country because many of these scholars have gone on to occupy prominent positions at Jewish Studies programs from east to west and north to south. She started to get the idea of making a truly major gift to go to the Jewish Studies program. The Stroum Lectures, they were endowed, and so was the series of books that are published out of the Stroum Lecture series. She gave more money after a while, which was to be used to hire faculty, prominent faculty, who would really bring very, very highly valued people in Jewish studies to the University of Washington. When half the money was given, the program would be named in honor of her and Sam. That happened a couple years ago. It was officially announced at the Stroum Lectures. It was a wonderful occasion for everybody involved.
Their impact has to be viewed not only in terms of the dollar amount and the particular things they supported, but they were also pioneers.
We really couldn't do all these things unless we had external support. And so having someone like Althea give us the generous gift she did enables us to have a really outstanding Jewish studies program, not only in terms of faculty who are excited to be here, but also the kinds of students we attract. It is a gift that we'll keep on giving and will help us remember Althea Stroum for a long time, because she is certainly one of the keys to why we have such a splendid Jewish studies program.
So the benefit of the Stroum's generosity and Althea's generosity in recent years is to benefit the students, benefit the community, benefit Jewish studies all around the world. I think that's pretty remarkable.
My husband and I always felt that if we could give back what was given to us by being blessed, that was our greatest contribution.
Althea's legacy will live on in every faculty member, University of Washington student, and community member. Her generosity touches every single day. We are incredibly grateful to her, and we cherish her memory. My name is Reshat Kasaba, and I am the director of the Jackson School of International Studies, of which, of course, the Stroum Jewish Studies program is a very valuable and integral part. I first met Althea in 2002 when I was, again, director for an interim period, and that was, of course, not a very easy time for her. It was not that long after she lost her husband, but I was impressed, I genuinely impressed by how interested she was in finding out who I was and what my interests were, and we had a lovely lunch, and I remember that very fondly. And the next time I saw Althea was actually, turned out to be the last time I saw her. That was also during Noam Bianco's book launch party, and even though she wasn't feeling very good at the time, she said she could not miss it for the world. I know she was enormously proud to be a part of the University of Washington community. She served on the Jackson School's advisory board for well over a decade. She played the important role of connector, helping bring members of the community together with faculty and leaders on campus to build on the mission of the school. When Sam, of blessed memory, passed away in 2001, instead of disappearing, Althea stepped up her involvement with the school, culminating with her extraordinary gift to Jewish studies. Her gift was tied to a vision she had for the program, a world-class center for the study of Judaism and Jewish life around the world and throughout the time. And every single day, we are coming closer to that goal because of her contribution. In addition to the lecture series you are attending tonight, Althea's generosity supports the Hazel D. Cole Fellowship in Jewish Studies, named for her late sister. After a series of very distinguished and prominent young scholars, we currently have Richard Benton as a Hazel Cole Fellow of Jewish Studies with us this year, who is an expert in biblical studies, a graduate from University of Wisconsin. I think Richard is with us. Althea's generosity also provides critical funding to honor and expand our faculty, including, of course, the hiring of Professor Noam Pianko, who has just been promoted to associate professor with tenure at the University of Washington. Noam, which means he will be with us for a very, very long time. And I'm also very happy to announce to you that in these times of extreme financial difficulties, we have been successful in hiring yet a new faculty member, Devin Narr, who will be joining the University of Washington in the fall. And this is almost entirely as a result of Althea's ongoing support for the program. Devin Narr is a student of Aaron Rodrigue, who was one of the Stroum Lecture speakers from Stanford University. And Professor Rodrigue describes Devin Narr as his best student ever. Devin is a scholar who studies a Jewish community in Salonika in Greece and talks about how this community dealt with the end of empire, coming of the Greek state, and also the coming of the Holocaust in that very important, crucial period of time. And I think he is an excellent sort of representation of the kind of faculty we seek to hire, who not only specializes in an area, in a field, in a very deep and important way, but is able to bridge across other programs and specialties and provide an environment where different people with different expertise can talk to each other. And we're looking forward to having Devin as part of our faculty. Today, as you know, private philanthropy is more critical than ever to the future of the University of Washington. As our former president, Bill Gerberding, said in the video, Sam and Althea were true pioneers, giving back to the community to support the things that matter most to them and inspiring others to follow suit. I know that Althea was glad to have lived long enough to see the impact of her gift on the Jewish Studies program. May this golden legacy live on from generation to generation. Thank you for coming.
So again, we are very, very fortunate and lucky to have Professor Kasaba as the director of the Jackson School and to be part of the Jackson School. And now, by your permission, I would like to introduce the speaker of tonight and the guest of the Stroum Lectures for 2011, Professor Jonathan Sarna. Professor Sarna is a Joseph Brown Professor of American Jewish History at Brandeis University and Director of the Orenstein Jewish Professional Leadership Program. He was defined by the Forward newspaper as one of the America 50 most influential American Jews. He was a chief historian for the 350 commemoration of the American Jewish community and is recognized as a leading commentator on American Jewish history, religion, and life. Dr. Sarna attended Brandeis University, the Boston Hebrew College, Merkaz Arav in Jerusalem, which is a very prestigious yeshiva, and Yale University, where he obtained his PhD in 1979. From 1979 until 1990, Dr. Sarna talked at Hebrew Union College at the Jewish Institute, where he obtained, where he became later on a professor before moving again to Brandeis University, where he served twice as a chair of the Department of Jewish Studies. Additionally, Professor Sarna is in the board of the Jacob Breder Marcus Center of the American Jewish Archives. In addition, he served as a chief historian of the National Museum of American Jewish History in Philadelphia. Dr. Sarna has written, edited, and co-edited more than 20 books, and on top of it also hundreds of articles about American Jewish life and American Jewish history. One of his books, among many others, American Judaism, a History, was the winner of the Jewish Book Council Jewish Book of the Year in 2004, and it has been praised as being the single best description of American Judaism during its 350 years on American soil. I am very, very proud and delighted to invite Dr. Sarna to give his lectures. Thanks very much. Thanks.
Well, thank you very much. It really is a great honor and a privilege to be here. The Stroum Lecture Series really is the most distinguished Jewish lecture series in the United States, and it has brought us a host of memorable volumes from the late Yosef Chaim Yerushalmi's Zachor onward. I well remember the excitement of my mentor, Professor Jacob Rader Marcus, when he was invited to deliver these lectures many years ago, and it is therefore with some considerable humility and also with immense gratitude that I stand before you this evening. Now, this is, I think, a very propitious moment to think anew about revivals and awakenings in American Jewish life. Some three decades ago, in 1982, an article appeared heralding what the author, me, called a great American Jewish awakening. I pointed out in that article that there were a wide range of then new and surprising developments in American Jewish life. The emergence of Reformed Jews who kept kosher, observed Shabbat, prayed with their heads covered and draped in talitot, in prayer shawls, and then the turn to modern orthodoxy on the part of some conservative Jews and their children, and the rightward shift within orthodoxy itself, and most remarkably, what was then called the BT movement, the large number of Baalei Teshuvah, born-again Jews, we might translate that, who underwent sudden transformations from the secular culture of the 60s to traditional, sometimes even Hasidic Judaism. To explain those developments, which I characterized then as a religious awakening, I pointed to three factors. First, a reaction to the liberalism of the 1960s. The 60s had witnessed a shift leftward across the country. The 70s witnessed a reactive shift in the other direction. Second, I argued that the turn to religion represented a renewed search for meaning, direction, and truth following an era of disappointments and doubts. Think Vietnam, and Watergate, and three horrific assassinations. I think we lost some sound here. Yeah, we're back, okay. And third, in terms of Jewish history, it seemed to me that we were witnessing another turn in a well-known cycle of assimilation and traditionalism, a dynamic in which tolerance and the lure of secular culture drives Jews towards assimilation, and then intolerance and fear of assimilation drives them back towards towards tradition. And this dynamic, I suggested then, had many analogs in Jewish history, and the turn in tradition would likewise, I suggested, in due time, burn itself out. So I closed with a warning then that the current American Jewish revival may not last nearly as long as some Orthodox triumphalists believe. I hoped, following the teachings of one of the great students of American Protestant revivalism, Professor William McLaughlin, that, quote, from the thesis and antithesis of the revival generation, a new synthesis would emerge. But I warned, as McLaughlin did, that the old light never quite dies, and the process is never finished. Now, how important the late 20th century awakening that I identified back in 1982 actually proved to be remains a matter of dispute. But having gone out on a limb then, let me be equally daring now and suggest that three decades later, the great American Jewish awakening of the late 20th century can safely be consigned to history. Indeed, throughout the country in 2011, we see synagogue membership in decline. The average decline is about 20%. By contrast, the number of Jews who describe themselves not in religious terms, but as, quote, just Jewish or secular, is up. As many as 25% of American Jews describe themselves in these terms. Meanwhile, courses in secular Judaism are proliferating on college campuses, including my own, and a new book on the subject by Professor David Beale has attracted much attention. Rebecca Goldstein has become something of a prophet for secular Jews. See most recently her Betraying Spinoza, the Renegade Jew Who Gave Us Modernity, and her novel, 36 Arguments for the Existence of God, : a work of fiction. Yesterday's New York Times reported that one can now major in secular studies at one American college, and I suspect it will not be the last. Where once enthusiasm swirled around the practice of Judaism, think the Jewish catalog billed as a do-it-yourself kit, now it is Jewish culture, much of it decidedly secular, that excites young Jews. Quote, we are in the midst of a Jewish cultural renaissance in America, the Foundation for Jewish Culture proclaimed a few years ago. When you see feature films reflecting the Jewish experience in your local Cineplex, attend readings of new Jewish writing in your local bookstore. Listen to new Jewish music in downtown jazz clubs. Visit thousands of Jewish websites on the internet. Take courses in Jewish studies on college campuses across the country. There can be little doubt, so the foundation argued, that we are in a golden age of Jewish culture, unlike any in the 4,000-year history of the Jewish people. Jewish book festivals, film festivals, folk festivals are really, for some Jews, what the Jewish holidays have traditionally been: annual cultural events celebrated at approximately the same time in communities coast to coast. Across the United States, evidence suggests that among Jews, culture is up and religion is down. Nor is this phenomenon unique to Jews. Indeed, outside of Jewish circles too, we are witnessing what might be termed a great religious recession. Robert Putnam and David Campbell, in their recent book entitled American Grace, provide a plethora of evidence to make the case that religion is ebbing among young people. More and more post-boomer young Americans, about a quarter of them, roughly three times the number as in 1980, describe their religious preference as none, N-O-N-E. Like a lot of Catholic nuns in their day, these nuns have kicked the habit and now describe their religion as, quote, nothing in particular. Now, whether the religious decline that Putnam and Campbell discern represents a long-term trend remains to be seen. As an historian, I have my doubts. Indeed, what we shall see over these two lectures is that at least among American Jews, cycles of religious revitalization and cycles of religious declension have followed one another with some regularity through the course of American Jewish history. Moreover, it is important to remember, as I have suggested, that religious declension in America does not necessarily walk hand in hand with cultural declension. The 1920s and 1930s, which historian Robert Handy famously characterized as an era of American religious depression, and which marked for Jews the nadir of traditional Jewish religious life in the 20th century, nevertheless witnessed an outpouring of secular Jewish culture, including Al Jolson's The Jazz Singer in 1927, Henry Roth's 1934 classic, Call It Sleep. Culture and religion, in other words, do not operate on parallel cycles of creativity. Now, in discussing revivals and awakenings in American Judaism, my hope is to shed new light on cyclical developments within American Judaism, and to do so with special reference to young people. For historically, among Jews, as actually among non-Jews, young people have been the engine behind religious awakenings. Widespread movement by young people toward religion heralds a communal religious revival. Widespread movement among young people in the other direction, toward universalism, secular social movements, the arts, and the like, signal that religious revival is past, and perhaps, if we are lucky, that a secular or cultural revival is aborning. Now, in employing words like revival, I am well aware that I am stepping into a scholarly minefield. A generation of scholars has depicted awakenings and revivals as inventions or interpretive fiction, perhaps, quote, more a cycle in the attention of secular writers than in the extent of actual religious excitement. The Great Awakening of the late colonial era, for example, has lost much of its greatness in contemporary historical textbooks. Its reach and effect, scholars now believe, have been greatly exaggerated. Nevertheless, we know that on the micro level, most people experience religious ups and downs throughout the course of their lifetimes. From biblical times onward, think Abraham or Moses or Queen Esther, religion and faith have never been static. They rise and fall and are perhaps best analogized to a lifelong journey filled with peaks and valleys. Comparatively few people maintain precisely the same set of religious practices and commitments throughout the course of their lives, and people who never change are so boring that you probably wouldn't want to know them anyway. And the same religious cycles hold true on the macro level. Revitalization movements have characterized human society since far back in antiquity. They represent major cultural reorientations, a search for new meaning, order, and direction in a society which finds that rapid change and unexpected intrusion have disrupted the order of life. The history of the United States and of most countries reflect eras of religious efflorescence, meaning heightened interest in worship and the practice of religion, and also eras of religious decline, just as history recalls eras of artistic and cultural efflorescence and decline. These eras of efflorescence, for example, the Hasidic revolution in Judaism, or the Great Awakenings that shaped and reshaped American religion, have lasting consequences. They define new religious norms that survive long after the people who created them have passed from the scene. So it was with the first known era of Jewish religious efflorescence in America, beginning in the mid-1820s. The American Jewish community was still microscopic at that time, maybe 3,000 strong, meaning that of every 10,000 Americans, only 3 were Jews. Most of those Jews lived in port cities like Charleston and New York, and with the minor exception of Philadelphia, each of these port cities still followed the synagogue community form of Jewish life known from the colonial era. There was exactly one synagogue per community. It welcomed in all Jews, but was run according to Sephardic tradition, and it assumed responsibility for all aspects of Jewish religious life, communal worship, dietary laws, life cycle events, education, philanthropy, ties to Jews around the world, oversight of the cemetery and of the ritual bath, even the baking of matzah and the distribution of Passover charoset used at the Seder. All of that was overseen by the synagogue community. It saw itself and was seen by others as the representative body of the Jewish community. It acted in the name of all area Jews, and it maintained communal discipline, usually through fines and the denial of communal honors. The advantage of this established synagogue system, from a Jewish point of view, were considerable, many advantages. The synagogue community was an efficient means of meeting the needs of an outpost Jewish community. It promoted group solidarity and discipline, evoked a sense of tradition, as well as a feeling of kinship towards similarly organized synagogue communities throughout the Jewish world. It enhanced the chances that even small clusters of Jews, remote from the wellsprings of Jewish learning, could survive from one generation to the next. By contrast, freedom and democracy, as we understand those terms, the right to dissent, the right to challenge the leadership in a free election, the right to secede and establish a competing congregation, the right to practice Judaism independently, these were unknown in colonial and early American synagogues. Jews of that time would have viewed such revolutionary ideas as dangerous to Judaism and to the welfare of the Jewish community as a whole. Yet precisely these revolutionary ideas were legitimated by the American Revolution. In rebelling against the colonists, in rebelling against the British, the colonists explicitly rejected both tradition and deference, central pillars of society in colonial days, and they overthrew many of the established patterns of life that had previously governed their existence under the British. In the Revolution's wake, American religion generally was buffeted by forces of change. Anglicanism greatly declined. Secularism markedly advanced. Many of our founding fathers, as a result, were deists and Unitarians. They bowed down, if at all, to the God of reason. Other Americans, especially in the South and the West, were so-called worldlings. They violated heavenly commandments and observed the Sabbath, if at all, by, quote, hunting, sporting, horse racing, jumping, and foot racing. Judaism, too, underwent great changes in the Revolution's wake. A majority of Jews had supported the revolution, including the Chazan, the minister of Sheret Israel, Gershom Sashus, who left the city with his followers in the wake of British occupation. Following the revolution in all of the communities where Jews lived, patriotic Jews returned to their synagogues, and very quickly we see them grappling with the new situation in which they found themselves. The challenge that they faced was whether Judaism, as they knew it, that synagogue community model of Judaism, could be reconciled with freedom and democracy. Could Jews maintain that traditional synagogue community structure that bound them together and promoted group survival, and yet at the same time also accommodate new political and cultural and religious realities? And the answer to that question turned out to be a resounding no. For almost half a century, synagogues attempted to preserve their traditional authority, but they failed. In 1782, for example, they proved unable to prevent Jacob I. Cohen of Richmond from marrying a convert to Judaism named Esther Mordecai. She was born Elizabeth Whitlock. Jewish law, traditional Jewish law, forbids a member of the priesthood, like Cohen from marrying a convert would still be not permitted in Israel. But Jacob I. Cohen was 38 and in love, and he thought that he should have the right to marry whomever he liked. The fact that Congregation Mikveh Israel in Philadelphia refused to conduct or to sanction his marriage did not stop him. Instead, in a public act of defiance, that congregation's leading member, Chaim Solomon, along with the Revolutionary War hero Mordechai Schefftel of Savannah and the well-respected old-time Philadelphian Israel Jacobs, privately conducted and witnessed the wedding ceremony. In so doing, they served notice that the synagogue's power to regulate Jewish life in a free country was waning. The synagogue got the message. In this country, they explained to the Ashkenazi chief rabbi of Amsterdam, Rabbi Saul Halevi Löwenstam, in a letter in 1785, in this country, everyone does as he pleases. Yet the Kahal, the community, has no authority to restrain or punish anyone except for the nominal penalty of denying them synagogue honors or of withholding from them sacred rites. However, the letter continued, these vicious people completely disregard such measures and continue to attend our synagogues because under the laws of the country, it is impossible to enjoin them from so doing, unquote. Over the next 40 years, the hierarchic, deferential, and tradition-based world of colonial Judaism gave way to a new Jewish world, one where Jewish law and the authority of synagogue leaders could be openly challenged, where every man, and not just wealthy landowners, was considered a yachid. That's the Jewish equivalent of what Protestants call a communicant, and where power no longer lay exclusively in the hands of wealthy elders. Jews demanded more religious freedom. For example, the freedom to select or purchase seats within the synagogue rather than having a seat assigned to them, as had been the case before. The freedom to buy kosher meat anywhere, and not just from the shochet, the ritual slaughterer that the synagogue happened to hire. The freedom to bury dear ones in a private family cemetery, if that's what one chose to do, rather than in the synagogue's cemetery. Freedom even led some Jews to abandon the synagogue and, yes, to abandon Judaism. Two sons of the prominent Jewish merchants, Michael and Miriam Gratz, intermarried, and they were certainly not alone. We are fallen on evil times, a prominent Jew proclaimed in the 1790s. But as it turned out, freedom also drew some young Jews back to Judaism. In New York, in Charleston, and later in other communities, young Jews with renewed interest in Judaism seceded from the synagogue communities that had dominated Jewish religious life since colonial times and insisted upon their right to worship apart as they saw fit. Now, scholars have pointed to a range of influences that likely motivated these young Jews in New York and Charleston: the Protestant Second Great Awakening, the challenge posed by Christian missionaries, the influence of Reform Judaism in Germany, concern for Jewish rights in the United States, and more. The young people themselves, however, actually focused on two points. First, that Judaism needed to change if it was going to survive, and second, that freedom justified the changes that they advocated. Charleston's young Jews, the Charleston Reformers, enumerated a series of radical reforms in Judaism that they considered it vital to promulgate, and in so doing, they proudly denominated themselves, quote, free citizens of America. New York's more religiously conservative young Jews sought to save Judaism in more conservative ways by promoting, quote, the study of our holy law so as to better extend a knowledge of its divine precepts, ceremonies, and worship among our brethren generally and the inquiring youth in particular. But amazingly, they too justified their claims on the basis of American freedom, quote, the wise and republican laws of this country based upon universal toleration, giving to every citizen and sojourner the right to worship according to the dictate of his conscience. In short, in both communities, albeit in different ways, young people challenged the authority of the once unified synagogue community, insisting that America recognize their right to withdraw and worship as they saw fit. And the result of this revival was nothing less than a new American Judaism, a Judaism that was diverse, pluralistic, and far more in harmony with surrounding American culture. By the Civil War, every significant American Jewish community contained multiple competing independent synagogues. That had become the dominant religious pattern for Jews no less than for Protestants. Young Jews, many of them freshly excited about Judaism, dissatisfied with what they had experienced in America's old one-per-community synagogues, and fearful that Judaism would not continue unless it changed, had produced a religious revolution that overthrew the synagogue community model of Judaism existing since colonial times, and they replaced a monolithic Judaism with one that was much more democratic and free and diverse and competitive. In many ways, American Judaism as we still know it today was shaped by that religious revival back in the 1820s. That's why there are so many competing synagogues in Seattle rather than just one. Now, within half a century, American Judaism seemed once again to be in crisis. The mid-1870s witnessed fears that, quote, Judaism is dying. Some young Jews left the temples where they had been raised for a new movement known as ethical culture. It was founded and headed by the son of a rabbi, Felix Adler, but it proclaimed itself to be universal rather than Jewish. Traditional synagogues, meanwhile, foundered. Some, like B'nai Jeshurun in New York and Ohavei Shalom in Boston, moved into the Reform camp. In San Francisco, according to one report, the men kept, quote, no Sabbath, nothing besides Rosh Hashanah and Kippur. There and elsewhere, houses of worship were described as being, quote, all in debt and poorly attended. Jewish secular culture thrived during this period, with more American Jews than ever before involved in literature and the arts, but attendance at synagogues and temples plummeted. Now, elsewhere, I've set forth at some length how a group of young Jews in New York and Philadelphia, believing that the future of American Judaism rested on their shoulders, stimulated an American Jewish awakening in response to this crisis. Thanks in large part to them, from the late 1870s until World War I, a major cultural reorientation took place within the American Jewish community. It was initiated, as usual, by young, largely native-born Jews, and then augmented by the mass migration of East European Jews. It resulted in a return to religion, a heightened sense of Jewish peoplehood and particularism, as opposed to the earlier emphasis on universalism and upon Judaism as a faith. It led to new opportunities and responsibilities for Jewish women, a renewed community-wide emphasis on education and culture, a burst of organizational energy, meaning, as we shall see, a whole host of new Jewish organizations were formed, and it led to the emergence of two movements that would transform 20th century Jewish life, Zionism and conservative Judaism. In the time that remains here, which isn't quite enough to do justice to the subject, I want to set forth some of the key factors that helped to explain the late 19th century awakening, as well as factors that seem to me to have been essential to its long-term success. Why, to begin with the most obvious question, did young American Jews return to Judaism in the late 19th century, contrary to all expectations? At a deep level, it seems to me that they, like the young Jews of the post-revolutionary era, were experiencing a period of rapid change and unexpected intrusions that disrupted their lives and called into question some of the major assumptions upon which they had been raised. These young Jews had grown up as children during a period of confident optimism in the years immediately following the Civil War. The Jewish community's wealth and political power greatly expanded during those years, especially, although this comes to as a surprise to many people, especially under the presidency of Ulysses S. Grant. Liberal Jews and Protestants spoke warmly of universalism. Jews dreamed of a, quote, new era, ushering in the golden age of a true universal brotherhood. But beginning in the second half of the 1870s, burgeoning anti-Semitism, calls for Christian America, the challenge to Judaism posed by Felix Adler's de-Judaized ethical culture movement, which I mentioned, and growing alarm over indifference, ignorance, and intermarriage, three I's in Jewish life, dashed all of these optimistic hopes. And this posed a cultural crisis of the highest order for American Jews. And as is almost always the case, it was young Jews who were the first to discern that crisis. They understood before their parents did. that old assumptions concerning, quote, a golden age of true universal brotherhood needed to be replaced, false paradigms forsaken. The great question for contemporary Judaism is whether it will continue God's work or cease to be. The young Max Cohen, later librarian of New York's Maimonides Library, wrote in one of his letters, Israel must be, he concluded, whatever its children make it. By the way, he was all of 26 when he wrote that letter, and his high-minded missive concluded with the hurried note, Mother is calling, it is time to blow out my lamp. Cohen's closest friends were all like himself, members of a secret organization called Kiyam Dishmaya, an Aramaic term signifying their goal to uphold the dictates of heaven. The group's goal was to save the Judaism that they believed the old generation was squandering and to engage in activities that would redeem Jews to the ancient faith. All around them, these young late 19th century Jews were witnessing an enormous social and economic transformation. Historians speak of this era, say roughly from the 1870s to 1914, as the Second Industrial Revolution. During those years, migration changed the face of the United States. Railroads and steamships tied distant regions together. Urban transportation networks like the subway and the trolley car bound big cities. The telegraph and then the telephone, invented in 1876, revolutionized business and personal communications. Electrification, of course, soon transformed many additional aspects of American life as well. For young people coming of age, these were wonderfully exciting times, filled with technological innovations that radically reshaped their lives, akin in many ways to the wondrous high-tech revolution of our own day. And unsurprisingly, young people experiencing change in a positive way look to introduce changes in their Jewish lives as well. In some cases, they also sought to employ new technologies to Jewish ends. This was especially true of the revolution in transportation and communication, which far-flung Jews benefited from enormously. The point is that rapid change in the social and economic spheres promoted change in the Jewish sphere as well. These three critical factors, first a cultural crisis, a disjunction between expectations and results, second, fear for Jewish survival, and third, a period of social and economic transformation linked to technological change, help to explain the late 19th century Jewish awakening. But then there are three additional factors that seem to me to have been critical to its ongoing success. First, the awakening supporters were fortunate to find leaders who provided meaning and direction to those looking to transform Jewish life. Cyrus Sulzberger was the man who organized Kiyam Dishmaya. For a time, he led the group. But there were also other important leaders, Solomon Solis Cohen, Max Cohen, Mayor Sulzberger, Cyrus Adler, and notable women leaders, Mary Cohen, Nina Moraes Cohen, the young Henrietta Zold, and more briefly, Emma Lazarus, until she tragically died. Some of you know the name Emma Lazarus from the Statue of Liberty. And out in the West, in this part of the world, you had Ray Frank, until she got married. But absent this coterie of purpose-driven leaders, the movement of young people that we are discussing would never have gotten off the ground or achieved what it did. This is almost a truism when it comes to movements of social and religious change, but it bears repeating. Leadership matters. In addition to raising up leaders, young Jews in the late 19th century established organizations, one after another of them. Indeed, something of an organizational frenzy took hold in American Jewish life at the end of the late 19th century. Fully 13 of the 19 national Jewish organizations listed in the first volume of the American Jewish Yearbook were founded in the century's last two decades, and many, many more local organizations. These organizations, analogous to the, quote, benevolent empire founded by Protestants in the beginning of the 19th century, sought to provide meaning and direction to Jews suffering from the social and cultural strains of a transitional era. They mobilized underserved populations, notably women. They took advantage of the era's technological innovations, and they promoted the goals of Jewish cultural and religious renewal. As a group, they reflected the 19th century Jewish awakening's most important goals and values: cultural and religious renewal on the one hand, promotion of Jewish education on the other. Finally, in addition to leaders and new organizations, the movement that began in the late 1870s sought to advance its goals through the written word. The American Hebrew, a New York Jewish newspaper founded in 1879, served as a prime vehicle of expression for the young Jews who were attempting to transform American Jewry. It provided them with a platform from which to advance their cause. No movement of religious renewal can advance without such a platform. For in the end, it is not enough just to have able leaders and innovative organizations. To succeed, a movement of religious renewal must also vigorously promote its program in the marketplace of ideas. Many of the ideas developed in the late 19th century, especially concerning adult Jewish education, religious tradition, empowerment of women, and Zionism, continued to shape American Jewish life well into the 20th century. So it was that twice in the 19th century, in the 1820s and again beginning in the late 1870s, young Jews challenged Jewish life as they knew it and sparked movements that gave new shape to American Jewish life. The 1820s gave birth to the pluralistic American Jewish community that we know, characterized by greater freedom, a multiplicity of competing synagogues, an absence of religious hierarchies. The late 1870s revival witnessed the emergence of well-organized religious movements, a heightened emphasis on Jewish peoplehood and Jewish education, a transformation in the role of women, a renewed interest in Jewish tradition and culture. Both of these religious awakenings changed the face of American Jewish life. As for the rest of the story, for that, you have to come back on Wednesday. Thank you very much.
thanks very much for a delightful, engaging lectures. We have about 20 minutes for QAs. If you ask questions, and concise questions would be highly virtuous, please use microphones. Yeah, it's
clear.
Yeah.
Okay.
Given the conditions for admission to the Jewish community that exists in periods of more religiosity or less religiosity, how does this free flow in and out of being more involved and more religious and less involved and less religious work over time? I mean, if they're freely marrying out of the religion and not allowed back in, or their children, how does that work?
It's an interesting question. In the 19th century, it wasn't, people made their own decisions, and it's quite fascinating to see how people moved in and out. So for example, in the 1820s, we have a man who we know had intermarried and moved out of the community. His name was Solomon Jackson. And yet, in the 1820s, he has a change of heart. And he moves back, and he edits a journal, which he boldly calls The Jew. And he fights Christian missionaries without any reference there to the fact that he had married out. And his children, who don't have a Jewish mother, and nevertheless are part of the Jewish community. Now, it's clear that later there's some concern about the fact that people find their way in to the Jewish community in this way and haven't been converted halachically. There is a synagogue in Philadelphia that actually puts into its rules that nobody not born, that's a double negative, but nobody not born of a Jewish mother can be a member of this synagogue except for Moses Dropsy. who was probably the wealthiest member and important, and you know, so it was. So you kind of see a kind of ad hoc nature, and it's actually extremely interesting to see something already in the 19th century that we know today, which is that in the American setting, self-identity is a very important element in Jewish life. There's no government making these decisions, and people make a lot of the decisions themselves. I see there's another microphone there, so please, we'll move back and forth.
Yeah.
Much of what you were speaking of tonight seemed to focus on all the changes in American Judaism as being internally driven of immigration, both in the
So the question is, to what extent is immigration responsible? And it's a very perceptive question. Indeed, I would say that many histories of Jewish life, especially written by immigrants and their children, assume that immigration is the force that drives American Jewish history. And in a way, that's why I tried to suggest often that, to our surprise, it was native Jews who made these changes and not immigrants. Indeed, I think it makes sense that it would be the children and grandchildren of immigrants rather than the immigrants themselves. That doesn't mean that immigrants are unimportant or that immigrants didn't bring about great changes. Of course they did, and they continue to do so, and the American Jewish community has been greatly enriched by one immigrant wave after the other. But in terms of religion, very often the immigrant generation is happy to use religion as a way of reminding them of the world they left behind and kind of gradually perhaps moving them towards something new. It is very often the children of that first generation that is dissatisfied, who feel that the religion of their parents is unsatisfactory, or who pick up contradictions between what they think should be and what they find. And there are fascinating examples of Jews who are many years in America, who many generations in America, who become part of these movements of change. So the answer, I think, is that yes, immigration has brought about change, but in the world of religion, I am more impressed by young people as a source of change, and am not persuaded that the energy behind it comes from immigrants. Please.
You stress the young people, and you do talk in the 1870s to World War II about the role of women, but I wonder how you perceive the role of women during the 1850s when men began to have to work on the Sabbath, and women were the ones who filled the synagogues and probably brought their children with them.
It's certainly true that one of the characteristic features of American Judaism, even before the 1850s, is that women are involved religiously. That seems to be true very early. And the reason, I think, is that in American Protestantism, women were so deeply involved in religion, so much so that one historian argues that the history of American religion is women's history. Already in the colonial period, we can see women attending synagogue in America far more than they did in the Caribbean, not to speak of Europe. And the way we know that is that there are all sorts of battles over seats in the women's gallery, which suggests there aren't enough of them. And if you trace the number of seats in women's galleries in America, you find that by fairly early on, there are about as many seats for women as there are for men. Now, you're perfectly right that as we move forward in the 19th century, there are many complaints that the synagogue on Saturday morning is filled by women, largely because the men are out earning a living, and there's little doubt that the movement in Reform Judaism towards Friday night services or even Sunday morning services in the 19th century are propelled by a desire on the part of rabbis to address men and not just women. So that is important, but I don't think that that is necessarily leading to the kind of transformations I'm talking about here. In the late 19th century, there is this growing sense that women will save American Judaism. And that sense of women as saviors of Judaism does become very important. And of course, in the American setting, we also see a sense that women are responsible for religious education, very different than what you know in Europe. And we see that already with the Sunday school movement of Rebecca Gratz. That's largely a women's movement. And of course, in order to teach Sunday school, you have to know something, and therefore women's study. And what we don't, and then we'll move on, but the creation in the late 19th century, the beginning of Hebrew colleges in America, beginning with Gratz College, that's really a way of educating women. The big story of those Hebrew colleges is that women can come and get a Jewish education, which has not, an advanced Jewish education, which has not previously been possible, and all of that is very new and important. Back there, yes, please.
Yes, yes. I'm a Quinault Indian from the coast of Washington. I heard you on the radio earlier today speaking about cultural change and religious change in America. I'd like to speak about manifest destiny and your perspective of how American Indians were dealt with for a 100-year period and how Jewish culture was treated in America during the same time period.
Well, that would be a very long lecture. Let's just say Indians were dealt with very badly. And it's a story that you know, I think the better it was known, the more ashamed in some ways Americans would be about the treatment of Native Americans. I think one can argue that because America had other outgroups, Native Americans or blacks, the treatment of Jews was better in some respects in this country. You don't find a vast amount of Jewish involvement in Indian affairs, largely because Indian affairs in this country, it's one of the great secrets, don't tell anyone, but Indian affairs really were designed largely to Christianize the Indians. That was the policy under the late 19th century. It's an official policy. Jews were not very good at Christianizing the Indians. And basically, from the Civil War to World War II, you really only find one example of a Jew who plays a very significant role in Indian affairs. He's appointed by Ulysses S. Grant. I talk about him in a forthcoming book. They pretty well organize his career so that his role so that he doesn't, he's involved in the medical care of the Indians, not so much in day-to-day issues. And honestly, the Protestants make his life a misery because he's Jewish. They're very explicit about it. They say he's a wonderful doctor. He's done very good work, but alas, he's Jewish. And within a couple of years, he resigns. So that's really a different subject, but no question that it's an important one in American history. Yeah.
Thank you. After 1848, a young Jewish community in Europe began to come here and encourage to move west and all of the small towns and cities, Seattle and the rest, started to get Jewish communities. What effect did all of the next spreading across the country have on all these events you're talking about in the last two decades of the 19th century? Because there had to be some communication.
Question.
Everything else you
have. So the question is, to what extent, how does the story I've told relate to the coming of these German Jews? So let me give a couple of points here. The extent to which 1848 is critical is debated by historians. Actually, the migration from Central Europe starts earlier. It's clear that roughly speaking, maybe 3,000 Jews in 1820, 15,000 in 1840, 150,000 on the eve of the Civil War in 1860, a quarter of a million in 1880. That's not all due to immigration, but it gives you a sense of the growth. As you suggest, these Jews move across the length and breadth of the United States. the religious lives they lead are very much shaped by the First Awakening I'm talking about, and you can see that because they don't form just one synagogue, as in the colonial era. In community after community, they very rapidly form multiple synagogues, one that they go to, one that they don't go to, they wouldn't be caught dead in, and so on. But in real life, there'll be a German synagogue, a Polish synagogue. One of the proofs of this is the names of synagogues. In the 18th century, a large number of American synagogue names are millennial, messianic, a sense that Messiah will soon come and the remnant, Sheirit Israel, will be redeemed, or Mikveh Israel, and so on. All of that's messianic. In the 19th century, many of the names are peace names. And why are they peace names? Bet Shalom and various Ohave Shalom and so on. Why are they peace names? Because you've got all these Jews from different places, and the real question is, can they live together in peace? And for the most part, the answer was, it's usually a good indication. If it has a peace name, either it was a result of a dispute, or they feared one. Ohave Shalom in Boston, where I come from, this was Polish and German Jews getting together. They call themselves optimistically Ohave Shalom. They split within 6 years. And each group, by the way, steals the name. It took a court case to decide who are the real lovers of peace. That took a judge. So on. So the point of that is that pattern was shaped by what I talked about. The late 19th century, the movement that you can see elements. I mentioned all too briefly, and I can't go through the whole story here, but for example, Ray Frank is really the first example I know of a Jewish woman who goes around as a woman preaching Judaism and coming here to Spokane and finding synagogue and people say, well, if you'll give a talk, if you'll speak, we'll organize for the high holidays. And naturally, that a woman is going to give a talk brought a huge crowd, and that leads to religious development, and she becomes a Jewish women evangelist in a Protestant sense. And that, I think, is part of this late 19th century awakening in smaller communities. Yeah?
So this is the last question.
Last question, okay.
Well, I'm wondering if you could just elaborate more on what you just said. You mentioned how women in the latter half of the 1800s were starting organizations. You mentioned the College for Women's Jewish Studies. Besides teaching of, say, Sunday school teachers, what extent did you see that enter more into the synagogue services itself? Did you have other women who would give lectures, say, after the services? Did you have a development of the bat mitzvah idea even beginning to start? Were women
So the question is to say more about women, and certainly in the long version of this, I will. Of course, the most important institution created is the National Council of Jewish Women, and we forget that its original goal was the education of Jewish women. There was a very considerable amount of internal debate between traditionalist women and more reform-minded women, and the National Council later moves on to help immigrants. But many of those educational ideas are picked up later by Henrietta Zold, who founds Hadassah, which is really at the very end of this period of awakening. And Hadassah, I think, demonstrates the many new areas that women can enter into. Of course, it's talking about nursing, it's talking about a building of Palestine, but it's also talking a great deal about Jewish women's education. Within the world of the synagogue, there are beginning to be stirrings of women. So, for example, Hannah Solomon, who's actually that plays a leading role in the National Council of Jewish Women, is invited to speak from various congregations. And we see the beginning of the sisterhood movement that begins as the sisterhoods of personal service, which are really involved in helping needy Jewish immigrants and give women an important role. And later, as that shifts towards professional social workers, the world of sisterhood is created within the synagogue, playing an important, if ancillary, role in synagogue life. And then at the very end of this period, with the Women's Rights Amendment, we see synagogues of all kinds moving to admit women to voting rights within the synagogue, and in many cases, the head of the sisterhood for the first time will be invited to join the synagogue's board. And that was a revolution in many ways. The rise of the bat mitzvah is later. It's usually dated in America. It has some European antecedents and Sephardic antecedents. It's usually dated to Mordechai Kaplan, who made the first bat mitzvah for his daughter Judith. But actually, the bat mitzvah mostly grows in the post-World War II era. And I published a series of statistics of how that grows. And it had much to do with the fact that this was a way of promoting Jewish education among women. Young women, as well as among their male counterparts. Before that, confirmation helped to extend Jewish women's remaining, Jewish women's education, but confirmation was a group right. However, if you belong to a synagogue or a temple that had confirmation, look at the photographs of the old confirmants buried somewhere, usually in the basement. Over and over again, you'll see there are more women than men in those confirmation classes. And that's a very interesting development. And that, I think, already has its roots in the late 19th century, an indication of the growing involvement of women in American Judaism. So thank you very much. See you on Wednesday.
So Wednesday, same place, same time. We have receptions, and we have Professor Sarna books for sale and signature if you would like. Reception in Walker Ames' room.